Welcome, it's Jeremy Allen Gould. I'm coming to you today to confirm between God and of man that in fact the rumors that you have all heard are true. I started this podcast because I freaking love music. I was privileged enough to book amazing artists and bands in the past, and I was lucky enough to stay in touch with many of them to this day. This is a place to hear their stories. Thank you so much for riding along on this journey, and I hope you enjoy what you hear. With that said, the rumors are definitely true. Thank you for tuning in to this latest episode of the Rumors Are True podcast. My name is Jeremy, and today I welcome my friend, Mark Salomon. You know Mark from the bands The Crucified, Native Son, Stavesacre, Neon Horse, Outer Circle, White Letter, and the Never Was podcast. Mark and I have an awesome conversation about his intro into music, a lot of the records he's worked on, throughout the years, his impact as an artist, it's just been a big part of my life in general. So I hope you enjoy this latest episode with the Almighty Mark Salomon. Mark, thanks so much for coming on my podcast, man. I really, really appreciate it.
Yeah. All thanks goes to you. Thanks for doing it, and happy to come on, man.
Awesome, Mark. Thanks. Tell me, what's going on in your life currently? What do you got going on, man?
Let's see. Middle of my work season, like the right in the middle of it. So just trying to be comfortable with I work in TV and I work a TV show that's on every week. Doesn't matter what it is. But the point is I'm in production, so I have, you know, I'm part of the moving of gear and setting up of gear and then maintaining it and then striking it all and moving to the next week. So it can be really stressful at the very beginning. It's nice to be in the middle and kind of settling into a little rhythm. We'll get super busy around Thanksgiving and then go back to regular normal stuff. And it's just all about trying to get through the season till the off season.
Yeah, man.
So right now we're trying to do little stuff around the house. We've been at this house in Florida for a long time. And you know, truthfully, the effort of my in-laws was huge. I mean, they have awesome. Put so much elbow grease into this house, man.
That's
so
cool.
That's what's going on.
That's sick, man. That's good to hear, man. I'm glad things are going.
Where are you working right now? Are you?
I'm in Florida, Jacksonville, and then I'm just doing my I was doing insurance inspections, and I got promoted, and now I'm a field operations manager, which is kind of cool.
Awesome.
Yeah,
awesome.
Can't complain, man. It's beats striking and tearing down stuff until 2 in the morning.
Dude, what about, do you still have any contact with the record pressing guys and all that?
Yeah. I talked to Jonathan and Walt here and there. Jonathan's out in LA actually. Uh-huh. And yeah, it's going pretty well. I was working there for, I don't know, a year or so. And I just, you know, wasn't paying the bills, not on their part, sure. but just, you know, it just didn't financially make sense. But
there's probably not a huge insurance package in pressing vinyl.
No, I don't think they've even taken a penny, honestly, like the owners. I don't think they've taken a penny in the 6 or 7 years, however long it's been open, which is, you know, crazy to think. But I mean, it's definitely a passion project is what it sounds like. And of course, see, they pay their guys and stuff. But yeah, I mean, they're doing really well, and I'm stoked for them, and they've put some awesome records out, which is really cool. So it's nice to have that in the backyard, which is kind of cool. So, well, speaking of, I was going to kind of go into where you and I actually met, which we kind of alluded to, our mutual friend, Ryan Luther. I don't know if I ever told you this, but I happened to be working the FSU game, and I don't remember who it was, but FSU, and you walked by, and I did a double take, and I text Ryan, and I was like, is Mark Salomon working this game? Like, am I seeing things right now? And I think Eric might have been working with us too, and I don't know why it didn't click in my head, but I was just like, oh my god, this is insane. You know, like, I've been a fan throughout my life, and of course, you know, I went up and met you and talked to you, and we've been friends ever since, and it's just been crazy to think that that's where we ended up meeting in a weird way. But It was awesome. It's like one of those stories that, like, I don't know. It's, if you get it, you get it. It's just like, whoa, that's insane.
Well, you know, for a band like Stavesacre in particular, you know, we sold some records, but we never even came close to like 100,000 units or anything like that of any single album. I bet you we didn't even break 50,000 units of any single album.
Whoa.
But that's not, you know, that doesn't even register in the pulse of commerce. But, you know, we still played a lot, and we did a lot of shows, and, you know, played with a bunch of different bands. So with even being that small, it is so crazy to me. Like, maybe I didn't, you know, make it per se, but literally every good gig and every cool thing that's ever happened to me, from being married to the jobs that I have to living in a place that I can afford, all those types of things came sort of through the experience of being a musician and playing in our shitty little band.
That's so amazing.
Yeah,
I love that, dude. That's cool. Sweet, man. Well, let's talk about growing up for you, man. And I know you've probably touched on this on other podcasts, but I'm just curious, just maybe some influences, some bands, some records that kind of put you in the route that you went in your life.
Yeah. Well, I didn't, you know, I lived in a pretty strict, it was strict, but it was not the way people think of strict. We, you know, my family were all, you know, they're basically Christians who used to be Hellraisers, and you know, the whole biker hippie thing in the 70s and all that. And, you know, 60s and 70s was weird. And my parents, when they became Christians, got super conservative and were really controlling in terms of what kind of music and artistic influences I had. So when the punk rock scene sort of unfolded in my world in the early 80s, I was like a, you know, sneaking into music kind of guy.
Yeah.
But in truth, the bridge between the music that my parents sort of had us listening to all the time and then punk rock was, to some people this might seem weird, but it was U2, you know.
Love U2.
A buddy at school, you know, I didn't have really many friends in high school. As a freshman and a sophomore, I didn't really know anybody, and we lived out in the middle of nowhere. I was growing up on the west side of Fresno. My parents became Christians, very quickly saw, like many people, that Fresno is a rough place to live. And so before we got too much older, I was 9, we moved out to the country to a little patch of dirt in Central California. And so there's not a lot of buddies out there, you know?
Yeah.
Not exactly hopping down the street to the local record store either. So my influences were whatever came through their filter. And then I go to high school, and, you know, in my sophomore year of high school, I met a guy named Randy who introduced me to this band that my parents would let me listen to, which was U2, because they were Christian guys. And, you know, I hear the album War. It changed my life.
Yes.
The song I was addicted to, the song Refugee, song. On that album. And I had never heard anything like it. And then, you know, now on my mind, cause I didn't really think much about music before that. Now I'm addicted to music right there from the spot. And, you know, next year in high school, between my sophomore and junior years, I turned punk because a kid moved into my neighborhood. He was like the only kid in my neighborhood. And so I went over his house. He came, Todd Thomas, he's like a semi-pro skateboarder. I go over to his house and he's got stacks of zines and all these records and all this stuff I'd never even knew existed. And I heard, you know, I got really into like the positive youth thing, you know, really big direct, like, what you call it? Youth Brigade fan. And, Minor Threat was my absolute, favorite band of all time from that era. Bad Brains, even like, some of the, like the, any of the kind of regional stuff, like, there was a band from Fresno called Capital Punishment that I found out existed and didn't even know that that was a thing. And, you know, we had Gilman Street up in San Francisco and then the LA punk scene and hardcore scene in Los Angeles. I just tapped into anything I could get my hands on, you know, Uniform Choice. Oh man, I love that Screaming for Change record. You know,
that's sweet, man. Were your parents cool with you listening to that stuff? I know you said it was kind of.
No. Absolutely not.
That's hilarious.
One jam of Minor Threat dropping F-bombs would have been the suspension of all music. So basically what I did was, okay, like my dad built our house, right? So we lived upstairs. My brother moved in. He was my stepbrother. And he finally moved in during high school. And we got to build out the upstairs. And my bed was sort of against this wall. And my dad sort of built like a cubby hole into the wall with a power outlet, and that's where I put my record player in. And I mean, that record player probably destroyed so many albums. Like, remember when you're a kid, you don't know how bad it is to have such a shitty needle.
Yep.
Just carving into the, you know, to the vinyl. But anyway, so that thing was inset into the wall. So there was like a little compartment behind it, you know, that you couldn't see. And I would borrow these records from Todd or from other guys from high school and bring them home and hide them behind the album.
I love that. You
know, oh, you're going to the record store? Yeah. What's it called? Tower? It's called Tower Records. Here, this is my allowance. Give me anything that's good. You know what I mean?
That's sick.
So, yeah, man. And then shortly after that, going to those Bibles, you know, like the, what do they call them? Christian bookstores, you know. Oh. Capitalism has found its way in the church, and
absolutely,
you know, you go in and you, I was looking for anything that sounded anything at all like any of the bands that I liked, and there just wasn't anything. You know, that was back in the era of, you know, this band from Orange County puts out a new, you know, this crunch Christian punk band puts out a new album and there's one song on it that you can play for your friends and the rest of it is just like, what is this, dude?
Yeah.
This is terrible.
Yeah. Well, so is that kind of what led you to maybe starting your own band? Obviously, The Crucified kind of came not far after that. Maybe talk about how you guys kind of came together. But let's talk about kind of that time in The Crucified as well, and maybe your thoughts looking back on that.
Yeah, so, you know, like The Crucified was basically like so many other Christian bands that existed before Tooth and Nail. It's like born out of necessity, you know. A lot of us Gen X kids, parents came from a pretty destructive time period. That whole post-60s thing, I think, scared a lot of parents, you know, about what was next for their kids. And they got real strict. And so there were a ton of kids who could only listen to Christian music.
Yep.
Anything that was called, quote, unquote, secular was out of, you know, it's verboten and it's a sign you're backsliding or something, you know, from a faith that you really don't know anything about. And you basically just agreed to because you were told you're Christian now.
Yeah.
You know? So little conscious, like passion there, but you know, anyway, the beginning was, it was also the beginning of deconstruction for sure.
Sure.
So, you know, all these bands, they were born because there was just nothing that you could play for your friends, and you wanted to listen to something that you could tell your parents, "Take it off my back, these guys are Christians." So we just started our own bands. And, you know, that in my sophomore year, I met all these Christian kids from school that started going to this Bible study, and they had a band called KGB.
Yeah.
And I was always, you know, being a kid all by myself out in the weeds with a little sister who had nothing interesting from, you know, we were buddies really. I just didn't have any friends. So I was drawing all the time. I would just sit down and draw comic books and stuff like that. And, you know, when I discovered music, I started drawing things that I thought were music related, you know, in my little tiny brain. And I met these kids at school. I started drawing on the back of their jackets and their shirts, you know, just trying to manufacture anything that looked as cool as the stuff that we liked, but was also okay to wear to church, you know?
Yeah.
And so I met these dudes in this band, and they called themselves KGB. And I asked them, "What did KGB stand for?" "We don't know. We just like the way the letters sound," because they were all really big GBH fans.
Yeah, so
there was like a certain aesthetic to the initials. You know what I mean? Like,
sure.
You can't have, you don't want it to spell something, you know, unless you want it to spell something, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so it just, there was like all these different, people were always changing the order of letters that they thought were aesthetically cooler sounding, but not necessarily meaning anything. So they came up through our conversations, we came up with Kids and God's Blessings, because I wanted to be able to draw real punk logos, you know?
Yeah.
And that was the name of the band. And then, you know, their singer and the band split ways. And so they asked me if I wanted to try out, and I did. And that was how I got into the band. We changed our name to Directed Youth, which was one of KGB's early songs. But, you know, I was all into that whole BYO positive youth thing. And, you know, Directed Youth sounded like something you would see on the back of a Youth Brigade record. And then we moved on from that, wanted something that was a little more less youth, because like our drummer was a man now, he's 18. He doesn't want to be known as a youth, you know? And so Jim Chaffin said, "There's so many other names we could have, and we haven't put anything out. Let's come up with a new name before we do our first demo tape, you know?" And I was like, "Well, what are some of the names?" And he spit out a couple of things. He's like, "You know, the Crucified or whatever." And I was like, "The Crucified, you know?" And then Galatians 2:20 was involved, so you could put it on all your t-shirts, you know? And so when you show up at youth group and they're like, "What's this?" You're like, "Look, it's Christian. There's the Bible verse, you know?" And the Crucified was empirically and aesthetically a badass name.
Yes.
And so that was the name we picked. And I started, you know, incorporating the crown of thorns and the cross and all my doodling and stuff like that. I doodled up that logo. And the next thing you know, dude, that was on every single thing we did for a long time and became a tattoo. And but again, it was literally because there was nothing cool.
Yeah.
I mean, our first show was with the Altar Boys, the only band that you could kind of play and not feel super embarrassed about. No offense to anybody else. They were doing what they were trying to do. It just wasn't what we were trying to do.
Sure.
And, you know, what was the band? God Rules. Undercover. Undercover had the two songs, you know.
Yeah.
Two songs. God Rules and Hey, Wait a Minute. Those were the two songs you could always play and be like, "See, these are punk, you know?"
Punks for Christ.
And then that whole thing started, which we hated. So I'm Not a Christian Punk was a thing that was born.
Yeah.
It's just, you know, organic things happen the same way all the time.
Were your parents okay? I mean, you mentioned they weren't. Were they okay with you being in a Christian punk band, or were they a little
very, very skeptical? Very skeptical. My mom was a photographer. You know, she had sort of taken up photography as a hobby, and she took us, you know, we asked her if she would shoot our band photos, you know? So we'd like, you know, look for a place that was cool out in the middle of nowhere, you know. We're in Madera Ranchos was where I grew up. And it's literally just a dirt patch. So we're like taking pictures in front of our well and pump house and stuff, you know.
That's amazing.
Back then, man, everybody wore a leather jacket every single day, no matter how hot it was or cold it was, you're wearing a leather jacket, you know.
Oh, yeah.
And so we're like walking around in the weeds. And then we went to Madera, the rough and tumble town of Madera, and took some photos over at the place where our drummer Jim, where he was working, Madera Produce. And my mom took those demos, and those pictures are in some of those early promo photos. They're in some of our old demos and stuff.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Well, looking back on the time of the Crucified, it sounds like you probably dig what you kind of planted, but at the same time, I'm sure there's some cringy parts of it. But looking back on it, how do you feel about your time, you know, the band in general, and maybe the mark that it left on a lot of people's lives?
I feel great about it. I got to pause for just a second. You can keep it going. I just want to do this really fast so that my wife can see. My dog wants to be in this room so bad.
That's so funny.
And she's sitting outside the door with her paw underneath the door like, I'm here. Hello. Anyway, sorry.
No worries.
My feelings on it are that it was great for what it was. I mean, yeah, man, there were some pretty cringy moments, definitely, you know, that led to cringier moments. And, you know, but when you're 14 and you don't know who you are, you're going to go through a few cycles before you figure out what you really want to do. And for a person like myself, it's essentially like a stunted growth, stunted maturity, still borderline child mentality. It took a little longer. I mean, I didn't really know who I was or what I wanted to be until my mid-20s, you know?
Yeah, same here.
So just, you know, and I don't know, I think that's probably fairly common, although some people, the ones who are truly great, I think, they know who they are from the get-go, you know? I was always a bit of a poser, so I just tried to find my way to fit in, you know? That's what happens in it. You're the oldest of really two kids, and then you get a stepbrother, and he has no interest in you whatsoever, although now me and my brother are closer than we ever were.
That's awesome.
You know, you just don't know who you are, dude.
Totally.
There's no scene in which to develop who you are. You know, it took a little while. So The Crucified was, you know, for me, that was like it was awesome. And absolutely like a blast. And dude, I mean, those guys, I always brag, I've never played in a band with a bad drummer, from the Crucified to Outer Circle to Stavesacre, obviously, to White Lighter and Neon Horse. Never, ever have I been in something where the drummer is just like, what, you know?
Yeah.
And if you have a good drummer, you can have a good band. And our guitar player was excellent. Greg was a great guitar player from early on. We traded bass players a lot, and then the fact that Jeff Ballou was the bass player in the Crucified at some point should say a lot about how great of a musician he was. So I got to play with a lot of really good musicians, and literally in every band. I'm not just saying that. Like, everybody had their own thing. Dirk, Brian, you know, Sam, Neil, like everybody. If you hear a Jason Martin guitar lick, you know who you're listening to, you know?
Yeah.
So, I don't know. I would say I am very appreciative of it. You know, my first introduction to music being U2, I always kind of had a little bit of a grandiose sort of idea of where music could go. And that was an eternally frustrating and somewhat disappointing thing to not go there, you know?
Yeah.
But I thought, man, there was a window there where I thought for sure that scene, that kind of post-hardcore scene, was where everything was going. And then 9/11 happened, and then the shit went south.
Looking back on the Crucified, what's your favorite record that you put out from that time?
Well, Pillars was definitely my favorite album. Like, it felt like a real album. The self-titled was just like a collection of every single song we've ever written.
Yeah.
You know, And when you're doing that, you're not thinking about the way you're not putting out an art piece that's called an album. And again, that was really not a thing that a lot of people were thinking about yet, you know. But then the 90s started approaching, and album concepts were becoming a thing. And, like, you know, this elevation from, like, hair bands to, like, a punk rock consciousness, but maybe a little broader swath of emotions, you know. Yeah. The grunge thing was born absolutely from the marriage of rock and punk rock. So I would say, to answer your question, I didn't know what making a record was until the 90s. And then right before we went to go track Pillars of Humanity, my buddy Alan Aguirre, Scatterfield, said, we played countless shows together, saw some wild shit together. Alan told me, hey, Mark, I've always loved The Crucified, but I can't listen to your records. It's not an album, you know? And no big deal, Alan. You just hurt my feelings. But no, I took it as kind of a gauntlet thing. Like, hey, man, I think he's right. It's like,
yeah,
we need to put out a piece of music that says where we are. And we are from Fresno, you know, at this point now. Everybody's back and living in the city. And, it's a weird town. It doesn't have a lot of things to hang its hat on. We just sort of thought, well, what is Fresno? Fresno was that. It's this sort of like, it's nowhere. You know, no town was a little slogan it had for a while, you know, which means it's nothing. It's nowhere. But it's also a very negative, we lead with no in Fresno, you know.
Yeah.
And so we wrote a record about that, man. You know, so-called living was a song about being a 21-year-old kid trying to afford an apartment in a city where, you know, dudes are in your apartment room when you come home from work. You know, who's this? Yes. Oh, they came through the window, you know. But also to try to write that piece of art from a place of very zealous faith, you know.
Yeah.
And I still didn't know who I was or what doctrine was or theology was. I hadn't studied anything yet. And there's good and bad things about that. But I would say that the so-called living and Pillars of Humanity, musically, definitely not artistically in terms of the album cover, but musically, it was the best thing we did at Stavesacre, as The Crucified.
Yeah, no, that makes sense. I would agree with that. That's probably my favorite as well.
It was honest. I will say this, dude, the two songs we wrote after that were going to be on the next Crucified record, they were really good, but they were not honest. You know, I was a bum, dude. I was a piece of shit. I didn't have a real job. I was constantly mooching off of people and, you know, had this overinflated, you know, ego. That's why you make solo records. You know what I mean? It was based on nothing. And it showed. And, you know, so those two songs, I was writing from a well of nothing.
Yeah.
You know, back to poserdom.
No, I got you. So the band ends, obviously, and let's kind of touch on the Native Son a little bit. I kind of tell me where that kind of came out, what that birthed from, and maybe your thoughts on that time. And, of course, Life in the Grave record. I'm just curious, you know, obviously it's a different outlet in terms of music. So, yeah, just curious what kind of where that began and what it brought from it, what you got from it, I guess.
I mean, it came from... I would say equal parts love for, I loved really like that filthy 70s and late 60s soul. I was a major, major Sly and the Family Stone fan. And at the heart of me, I wanted to make music that was that filthy sound. The bridge between The Crucified and Sly and the Family Stone isn't a practical one.
No, not at all.
And you know, it was the early 90s. So like 90s hip hop was, it was the new punk rock, man. It just took over everything. And, you know, in all honesty, like it was ignorant. Native Son was an ignorant record, you know, And I don't mean that necessarily in a negative way. I loved rap music, and I loved Public Enemy so much, dude. I would have listened to them every single day. I probably listened to them every single day. I loved the Beastie Boys. I loved everything that came out of Compton. Anything that had some ferocity to it and some unsettling message behind it,
totally.
I was into. And then I, you know, while that's happening, we spent a night, we stole some beers, you know, typical Christian singer of the Crucified would do. We stole some beers and sat, and Mark Johnson, the second bass player of the Crucified, we sat in his living room and drank this six pack of like Bud Light or something and got a massive headache and listened to this new record that he had. I don't know if he was out of the band yet or not, but it was called Paul's Boutique. And
it
was like the marriage of all this filthy funk music that I loved and hip hop together. And then, you know, you find out like all the production that was back when people were reading all the credits on records and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And you see the connection between that music, the production of that album, the Shock Lee brothers and Public Enemy. Like, there was all this stuff squashed together, the Bomb Squad and all that. And like, I was like, there's gotta be a marriage in there. And then, you know, on Public Enemy's, I think it's Nation of Millions, you know, she watched Channel Zero, has Kenny King or Kerry King, the guitar player from
Slayer.
From Slayer, and there's Def Jam, that's, you know, Slayer, Danzig. All that stuff is squashed together, and if you're not a great artist, you get Native Son. And that's pretty much what happened, dude. And it was definitely an identity crisis. I mean, you know, we're sitting there playing Crucified shows, and I'm sure Jim and Greg especially, and Blue always was just like talking shit constantly because he could see this identity crisis that I was in. And so, you know, but Jim never understood the obsession with rap music at all. So it was a double miss for him. And, he, you know, me on stage, dude, I'm like hopping around like I'm in every one of the music videos we were watching on MTV. You know, it was just probably a very, very painful thing for people to watch. But I meant every second of it, you know? There were two kind of transitional bands that squashed a lot of those things together for people. Again, the 90s were, you know, dude, they were full of this kind of stuff. But, I mean, how many bands, thrash metal bands, punk rock bands, how many bands took two or three weird steps to so they could squish into their band a Flea-style slap bass player?
Yeah.
I mean, think about that. Sacred Reich did it from the metal side. We were obsessed with the Sacred Reich. That's like an EP they put out. It was incredible. And then there was the Chili Peppers, you know, and Fishbone. So Sacred Reich tried to find a way to incorporate that stuff. Suicidal Tendencies end up kind of disintegrating and turning into Infectious Grooves. You remember that?
Yep.
It was like a really awkward time. There's plenty of footage out there for people to be embarrassed by. But, you know, I tried to do everything. And because I couldn't do much of anything, I wasn't a musician. I wasn't a producer. I wasn't a rapper, you know? The ignorance part, though, where it comes negative, was a complete lack of regard and education, truthfully, about cultural appropriation, dude. That was not a concept in 1989. Yeah. No one knew jack shit about that was white. No white people knew about that.
Totally.
And it really hadn't been communicated very well. You know, Judgment Night soundtrack.
I was going to say that. That's, you know, the, yeah, that was great. Yeah.
That was like, everything was so mixed up together. And honestly, that was the birth of Lollapalooza and a very cool cultural phenomenon. So there were good and bad. We lost a couple soldiers along the way. You know, for every Native Son, you get a Lollapalooza.
Hey, yeah. Hey, man.
You get Reality of My Surroundings or
that's,
you know,
Life in
the
Great.
You know.
That's
but the musicianship, dude. I mean, some of those guys that were in that band that played in – on that record with me, they were from a band in Fresno called Black Fry, and they were great. They were a very, very talented band.
That's very cool, man. Well,
AWOL Society.
You know, it sounds like, you know, even though it was kind of a blip in the radar, if you will, or of ignorance, as you say, I mean, it's still part of your past and part of your history. And you, like you said, the identity crisis of it all, you know, you kind of it still was an artistic outlet, which is cool. And mm-hmm. something that looking back on it, you know, it's kind of in your palette and your pantheon, I guess, if you will, of music, and it's still cool. I mean, I listened to it, you know, because I knew I was going to talk to you. It's just so different, but it's cool. Now that you've explained that, though, it makes a lot more sense, you know.
Yeah, you know, I mean, do I regret making it? It for a lot of reasons, yeah, but for a lot of reasons, no. I love hanging out with those guys making the record, Jeff and Wade in particular. You know, Wade Krause is an incredible drummer, and to this day, that guy in the weird periphery of former musicians who find like their own thing, he is like the authority on vintage pinball machines.
That's you know, so cool.
Those guys were great. And Tyler Burke told me one of the best stories I've ever heard in my life making that record. Anyone who is watching this, who's heard me tell it, all I'll say is PB&J. Jeremy, we can discuss this later. But, I would say that once it came out and once I saw the reaction of people, which by the way, there was a promo of that record that had quotes from all these people saying how good it was.
Wow.
And then none of them saying how good it was afterwards. You know what I mean? No one ever talked about it again.
That's hysterical.
You know, it was a chance to get on a promo poster. Why wouldn't you say something cool? But the what the best thing that came out of that was a complete devastation of the delusion I was living under. I mean, really.
Yeah.
I shortly after the album came out, I had burned every possible bridge in Fresno.
Wow.
I had hurt a lot of people's feelings. Mm. Had let a lot of people down, embarrassed a lot of people, and had these delusions of grandeur that were unfounded, you know? And so what happens with life, dude, it shows you real quick that that stuff ain't real. You know, I will mostly remember the post Native Son era as me living homeless for a couple months in Southern California, where my band, The Crucified, used to sell out every show we ever played.
Wow.
I was living in my truck and sleeping on floors my truck broke down. I got like really terrible jobs. I remember walking down to Topanga Canyon Road in 1993 with nothing. Just, wow. I have nothing. Every car driving by me is playing like, you know, The Chronic or whatever, or, you know, the latest. I remember hearing, you know, Let Me Ride. I feel like I heard that a lot. Walking down that street, you know, which is something that I kind of allude to later in the last Stavesacre album, just, you know, marking the time for me. But so with that era, just it broke me, dude. I mean, I think of it as my Nebuchadnezzar times where I'm out.
No, I get you.
My fingernails are like long antlers.
Man, hey, you know, at least you can look back on it and see that. That's kind of cool. You know, like you said, maybe you had to have those moments to get you to where you are now. And, you know, you know, it's cool that, you know, you can look back on that in that perspective, at least. So Stavesacre, let's talk about that. Yeah. I know you have such an extensive catalog, so I don't really want to go too far into it. And you probably talked about it a lot. But let's talk me through how the band kind of came together, maybe where the band name came from, and then I want you to tell me your favorite record, and we can talk about that one for a little bit.
Okay. I'll try and be quick. It's basically, I was all by myself. You know, Crucified broke up. Native Son went nowhere. I'm living in Southern California. I have really no contact, because when the Crucified broke up, Jeff, who was living in Southern California, when we first met him, he moved back home eventually. And, you know, through a year or so of just nonsense, I ended up, you know, I left my apartment in Woodland Hills and moved down to Orange County. Tim Mann from from
Focused
invited me to come and live with them. And through a long series of events, I definitely believe that God saved my life there.
That's awesome.
Why? I truly do not know. You know, I broke my lease in August of 93, in February of 94, when I still would have been living there with nothing. I mean, just barely making rent, just barely getting food to eat. That was the Northridge earthquake, and my apartment was destroyed. But wow. Because I was living in Huntington Beach, I was okay. And, you know, Clank was staying at our house. I don't know if you know who Clank is, but he was staying at the Newman house that all those bands came through, you know, Outnumbered and Unashamed.
Yeah.
You know, Focused. All these bands were there. It just was a good, it was a weird kind of humbling, but also a reconnection. So Baloo moves back down there. He knows all those Focused guys, including Dirk. Him and Dirk have been best friends forever, you know. And Dirk and everybody was always over at Newman House. I mean, there was always 25, 30 people there.
Wow.
And I met Jeremy Moffat. He came, he was my roommate for a while. And it got too crowded and too weird, and we all kind of moved to different places. But by reconnecting with Baloo, I lived in Long Beach for like 3 months right after Newman, and me and Baloo hung out a lot there. And, you know, he wasn't making any music. I wasn't making any music. And he's like, you know, let's do something. And I was just like, he's like, you know, are you ever going to do anything else? And I was like, yeah, I'd love to, but you know, I want to do something different. He's like, you want to make rap music? And I was like, no, dude, that is over. I understand the error of my ways. I want to do something different though. I want to do something that isn't being done yet. And there's gotta be a marriage of these styles of music, you know? So, shortly after that, I moved back down to Huntington Beach, and, Jeff and Dirt came by one night and they're like, this is what we want to do. And they hand me this stack of CDs, and it's like, this band Burn. I think it was a Jawbox or a Jawbreaker record.
Oh, Jawbox is great.
But two big ones that really just hit me like a ton of bricks was the first Quicksand album, Slip. Yeah,
it's great.
And the first Orange 9mm record.
Record.
Driver Not Included. And they're like, this is what we want to do. Do you want to do this? And I said, you know, yeah. And this weird thing happened where I'm, you know, like I said, I used to look through all the credits and kind of see where the connections were. I see this name on the Driver Not Included album, and it's Brian Karlstrom. And I had been introduced to Brian a few years earlier, and we remained friends. He was in line to produce the next Crucified album. So
wow.
That was the hope, that he would maybe do it.
Yeah.
Because he had worked on Alice in Chains' Dirt, and that sonically was just perfection in my mind. And, you know, we're never going to get Dave Jordan, but maybe we could get Brian, because, you know, his name's on this record too. Sure enough, you know, I started talking to him again about it, and we went to this new festival called the Warped Tour. And, you know, we practiced a couple times now, you know, we thought about doing some things. In the middle of that, I had started playing with Outer Circle, and my buddy Kevin, and Jeff and Dirk actually kind of came in to play with Outer Circle for a second, but it just wasn't what they wanted to do.
Sure.
So when they brought me that stack of CDs, it was just like, this is what we want to do. Now that probably makes a little bit more sense. But we all went to the Warped Tour and saw these bands play, you know, Orange 9mm was going to play, Sick of It All was going to play, and Quicksand was going to play. Like, that's a no-brainer. I'm going.
Yeah.
You know, this random band that had been floundering around Southern California and playing huge shows in LA and then nothing anywhere else was going to be having their biggest show ever. No Doubt is going to play the Warped Tour. Maybe this something's going to happen. And then, of course, came Tragic Kingdom and they blew up. But you know, there was this other scene of music there that I thought was really where everything was going.
Yeah.
And, you know, oh yeah, you should come and see this band play. They're called Deftones. And I have said this many times, but I hate ska.
Yeah.
I don't really truly hate ska. I just didn't
like
that era.
It's not your bag, baby.
I still listen to Madness. I still listen to Specials. But that era of ska, I wasn't feeling. And of course, you know, that became the biggest music form in the world. But, you know, oh, the Deftones, that's a ska band. I'm not going to see it.
I thought the same thing, dude. I thought the same thing.
Just come and see them. And sure enough, they weren't. And they were incredible. And right then we knew, like, this is it. This is where things are going. This is what we want to do. So the guys left Outer Circle, you know, and I said, you know, hey, Kevin, maybe we'll do something later, which we did, you know, a few years later. And then we started practicing with Jeremy. Jeremy was a drummer. He was my roommate. So we started playing, and he really wanted to do the Crucified. He wanted to reform the Crucified and start all over. But I was not interested in doing that.
Yeah.
You know, he eventually left Stavesacre and went on to be in the Blamed, and, you know, he wanted to play hardcore. So it worked out better because Sam was much more in tune with where we were at musically, and his discipline was incredible. It was it was a perfect transition for us. So how Stavesacre, in truth, like Stavesacre started in 95 and, you know, practicing in that little thing. And the idea to put out the 3-song demo 100% was inspired by the 3-song demo by the Deftones that was circling around Warped Tour. Like, that's the way you do it, man. Just record your own shit, put it out on a little demo tape and just pass it around, get people to talk about it maybe. And they did, you know?
No, that's cool. What, where'd the band name come from?
We didn't want anything that was significant of anything religious. We weren't trying to, at that point I had realized I am not a preacher. I just want to play music.
Yeah.
You know, but this is the scene that I know the most. I wish that I had not stayed in the Christian music scene. You know, it's easy to say now, but I think it would have been better for the band to see if we really had potential had we started somewhere else. But it wasn't conscious. It was just like, these guys will book us. Let's play that, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
There was no Christian music scene. There was Cornerstone, and that was it.
Yep.
And so we didn't want anything that was like so overtly Christian, you know. We didn't want to sell our faith. We just wanted to be a band. And Baloo was this weird guy who read the dictionary all the time. And he was looking, I feel like he was looking up the word staunch for something. And, you know, because that was all back then. That was all the bands were like single syllable, you know, or like one word. You know, or just always it was like, you know, shift.
Yeah.
Quicks, you know, I don't know.
Yeah.
Anyway,
no, I get you.
He's looking up staunch and burn. And sure enough, a tool. And he sees the word Stavesacre and he reads this definition and it's just insane. It's like this flour that was used, you know, in the 1800s or whatever. They would grind up the seeds and use it to kill rats.
Wow.
But then it also could produce this flour that was, you know, very beautiful, and that kind of represented the dichotomy, because our conversation was, we don't want to be everything all the time. Yeah. There are other emotions that we are feeling and we would like to communicate those. So that's where it came from.
That's cool. That's awesome. So, you know, Tooth and Nail kind of came into the picture with that, obviously. And, you know, did they come after you? Was it kind of like when you guys, you know, came together, did you pitch it to them, or how did that kind of happen?
Well, out of the Newman era, Brandon's evil came around and started, you know, he got to know everybody. And at the time, it was like, you guys got to meet this guy, Brandon. He wants to start his own record label. He used to work at Frontline. And, you know, he came around and everybody got to know him and stuff like that. And he showed some really incredible character back in the day. There were things that had happened back then around. There's a lot of, you know, broken kids back there.
Sure.
And we just, you know, everybody just kind of thought, you know, I think this guy might be all right. And, you know, I don't know how to say it, man. It sounds like I'm rewriting history. It's so simple, but it really isn't, dude. He saw the perfect opportunity. He basically took those conversations that everybody was having. This wasn't my revelation that all these records have one good song and the rest of the record you don't care about. Like, that was what everybody was thinking. And he had this thing where, like, why don't I just start a label that has all bands with all good songs. You know what I mean? Like,
totally.
All songs that you want to play for your friends. And, you know, when that Wish for Eden album came out, it was so in that Helmet, Quicksand kind of vibe that it just seemed like something inevitable was happening there. So when Stavesacre, you know, came together, you know, I think, you know, Brandon was a big Crucified fan. So he had been, you know, he put out our demos and stuff like that.
Yeah.
The Crucified demos were like the 10th release by Tooth and Nail. So when he found out about the new band, he was immediately interested. And it was just like, of course you're going to sign that record deal with it. You got to do it. Yeah. Like he wasn't That's happening. Amazing. He wasn't trying to hear that we were going to do something else. He was going to put that album out.
Yeah.
You know? And, you know, I think there was a shared fail there. You know, Brandon, I'm sure, would take back some things, and I'm sure I would take back some things. You know, there were expectations that we were, again, you can, delusions are stubborn.
Sure.
Dude, you know, I get it. That being said, he came to every chance he had to come to the studio. We reconnected with Brian Carlstrom. You know, Brian told me later that if Stavesacre had sounded like the Crucified, he was going to say no out the gate. He would have told me no if we asked him to do the Crucified. He wasn't interested in doing that kind of music. He wanted to do rock. And so when he heard the demo, he was blown away that we weren't playing punk rock. And he came down, and Brian and I drove up and down PCH in my old 64 T-Bird that's in the Outer Circle video, and listened to this demo over and over again. And he said, we're going to make this record. Let's do it.
That's cool. You know?
And I feel like that gave Brandon a little wind at his back. Like, man, this might actually be worth the investment. Because there was money that he spent right there to go to El Dorado Studios to have the album mastered by Brian Gardner, that, you know, big bass Brian, the absolute master of low end records, you know, legendary mastering engineer.
Yeah.
So, Brandon came to the studio, and I had just done my big emotional walk that I've talked about many times, where, you know, I took my cassette player and my cassette of all the new jams. And we had 5 songs mixed, and I was so excited. And I just popped them in my head and walked around Hollywood, you know, because I had thought for sure I was never going to make any music again. And I didn't know where my life was going.
Sure.
3-4 years later, here I am doing this. So it was incredible for me. But I was so proud of him. And then Brandon showed up, and it was just like the timing, dude, was perfect.
Yeah.
Like, I was so emotionally excited about the album. Brandon shows up, and we play it for him out in the car, and he's just freaking out, you know? And I remember his remark was, "This sounds like a general market record."
Oh.
Which is a statement that no one would ever say anymore. You know what I mean?
That's his
miracle. But truthfully, dude, like, it was hard to get records to sound like that. Like, how are they getting it?
Yeah.
You know, we didn't know a lot. I think everybody was learning a lot. You know?
Yeah, man, absolutely. Well, let me ask you, what's your favorite Stavesacre record? And let's talk about that record for just a few minutes. I know you guys have put out quite a few, and they're all, you know, equally awesome. But just curious what your favorite or is, I should say, and maybe your thoughts on it.
I mean, I love every Stavesacre record. I don't love the self-titled album, and there's a good reason for that. But for everything else, I loved everything. But I would say probably the album that I come back to the most is an EP, the Against the Silence EP that we did. It was when Baloo came back, you know, because he had been gone for a couple records. He helped write Speakeasy, absolutely. He was a huge part of that. But it was like Speakeasy took forever to finish. Mm. We didn't think we were ever going to finish the album. Brian was really, really sick. Recording had completely changed. Everything was shifting to digital, and all of our stuff was on digital files that most people didn't know how to access.
Wow.
A lot of people had never used Pro Tools before. Our album, our third album, Speakeasy, was spread over three different hard drives, dude.
Wow.
You know, that was back when Macintosh had these tower hard drives.
Yeah.
And like, nobody really knew what to do with it. It would be like getting all the parts of a human body and having zero idea how to reconnect them and being told, make a person.
Yeah. Know? No, totally.
Or else they'll die. You know what I mean? So after Baloo left and we did a couple things without him, I was really kind of sad, you know. And then Neil left and Baloo came back and we just all reconnected and we did Against the Silence. And that album, you know, I had become friends with Jason Martin, so he helped produce it. It was like the real core of all of our buddies yeah. together. You know, Steve Dale, also known as Dave Steele, by me, and Randy, like they were part of our crew. We were all really tight. And so we all got to work on stuff together, you know.
That's cool.
Because those guys had worked on How to Live with a Curse. So it just, you know, it was really a good thing to happen. And it was a very sincere record. And I felt like I had some of our best example of the different emotions we can go. You know, yeah, there wasn't really a Burning Clean or a silver and gold, you know, a gold and silver yeah. Moment there, but there were deep emotional expressions on that album, and I felt like it was cool. The guy who did the artwork was Tony Streeter. He was like one of our street team guys for years, and he had become, you know, a very talented designer, and he did the design for How to Live with a Curse, but none of us, it felt like we missed something there. So for him to be able to come back and kind of do it all himself was really cool.
That's cool.
You know, he did Bull Takes Fighter as well. It's just like, it was cool. It was cool to have all the guys together.
That's awesome.
I'm probably forgetting somebody, but. Oh, Brian Karlstrom. Brian Karlstrom didn't come back, but we did it with Jason Martin. So it just, again, it was like,
yeah,
everything
just all fell
seemed
into place.
To make sense.
Yeah. Yeah.
And dude, so. I mean, there's songs on there, that last song on that album is about my life story, basically.
That's, you know, cool.
Those songs that I'm talking about, I Was Out of Step, But Not Alone, that was about discovering Minor Threat and Youth Brigade and, you know, that That's whole, cool. like, Sound of Fury era. So, yeah.
That's awesome. What's your favorite Stavesacre song of all that you've written or been a part of, I should say? I know there's a lot, but...
I don't know that I have one. I will say, you know, my cousin came in when we got back together and did 1995, which was a great experience, you know, and sure. everybody, in truth, everybody had come back together at that point. I mean, Neil even came and hung out with us a few times. David Cotton was hanging out with us, you know, like we got to see a lot of the homies, all the, you know, the Air Shark Gorilla, those guys were there. But my cousin came. She's a drummer. She plays for a huge pop star right now, Olivia Rodrigo. But oh, Haley wow. was a great drummer. But also, this is before all of that stuff. She was a really talented artist and still is. She still makes music. She's probably DJing and then you know her day job. But I knew she was a singer. And back then, all I had heard her doing in terms of music was like sitting on the porch at my grandma's house. Playing the guitar and singing with her sisters. And, you know, she has such a sweet voice. So she was going to school at Cal State Northridge at the time. And I think had just graduated, was working for like Zildjian Cymbals and stuff. And I was like, hey dude, we're doing this song. It's about grandma and grandpa's house. Do you want to come?
That's cool.
And sit with me and sing with me. And she did. And she came and wrote her own part, which was really good, and I never would have thought of, and it was really sweet and awesome. That little da 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 da, da the way she sang everything, you know, it was beautiful. So, I would say that's probably my favorite song. It's about my, you know, a very important part of my life. So,
yeah, man, absolutely. That's really cool. That's cool that you guys got to play Furnace Fest a couple years ago. Get the band back together. How was that for you guys?
Yeah. It was great. It was great. It took a lot of work. It took a lot of people are always like, dude, how come you guys don't go back on the road? You should do a few more shows. Like, dude, do you have any idea?
Yeah, I know.
Like, people do still think that we're rich and we made money off of music, and none of us did. Not Stavesacre, nobody. There are about three bands that I know that we played shows with who made any real money, and literally everybody else is finding other ways to make dough.
Yeah.
But it was cool because we all, you know, we all got together out at Dirk's place out in Atlanta, you know, stayed together for a couple nights to really rehearse. You know, we did a lot of stuff online, which, you know, back in the day never would have been possible. And then, you know, we got to get in the room and make our ears ring again. And I mean, not for nothing, man, but I played with Jim Chaffin, dude. That guy is an absolute monster playing drums. But Sam West is still the, I don't know how to say this best. Of every drummer I played with, no one hits the drums with as much force as Sam West. It is, I can still remember the first couple times playing with him, like, dude, I am never going to be able to hear again. And now I have raging tinnitus all the time. But it was great to get together. You know, we saw Brian Gray, who ran the encore stages at Cornerstone and was the, you know, still does the Blamed, and, you know, was my roommate for 10 minutes at Newman, surprisingly. we saw Brandon Ebel again. We saw Billy Power.
Cool.
You know, all saw Ryan Luther. I mean, dude, Ryan Luther is the reason why I know you. He's the reason.
I know.
He's the reason why I have the job that I have right now.
He's truthfully amazing.
Between him and Alex Ruschetti, I would not have the career that I have, except that they were fans of Stavesacre. That is very bizarre.
That's amazing, dude. So real quick, just to sum this up, looking back on the band in general, what are your thoughts? I mean, it sounds like you have some fond memories of it, obviously. Just looking back at the mark that you guys maybe left.
I mean, they're my brothers, dude. And I will absolutely say, if the guys are listening to you, and you know who you are, we all love you. And we carry the weight. The weight is being carried. We are with you forever. So that's a fact. They're my brothers. I love them. And he knows who he is and who I'm talking to. But we, you know, life is rough, dude. There are ups and downs. And, you know, like you and I talked about right before we started, it's uncommon to meet people and to stay with them, even in the way like yourself and I are. But to have lifelong brothers like that who aren't in my family is invaluable. You know, what's the old page of the line? It's hard to find a friend. It's true. And it's real. So we love them. And, you know, if we ever play it again, it would be my absolute joy. I would love to do it. It was great to do Furnace Fest. It was great to make 1995. It was great to be able to put it out and hand it to people. All the stuff Unoriginal is doing to reissue our old records.
He's crushing it.
All of those things. You know, and that's we love doing it.
Man. Absolutely, man. Well, that's good to. I love that. I love hearing that, man. Sweet. Let's talk about some of these other records briefly. Outer Circle. You mentioned it earlier. You kind of were doing this while you were doing Stavesacre. Let's talk about that. How that kind of came together, and maybe the record you put out, and how that kind of came together.
Yeah, you know, Kevin and I have known each other longer than almost anybody I know. I've known him since I was 18. You know, he used to come to Crucified shows, and we'd hang out and talk all the time. And, you know, I met him and his first wife when they were still boyfriend and girlfriend out in our driveway out in the Ranchos. He's one of the only people who's outside of the Crucified who knows where I really did live. Anyway,
that's cool.
You know, he and I have known each other forever, and you know, he wanted to do this band, and he got these guys to play, Matt and Jesse, and you know, we jammed for a while. It was fun, but it just, at the time that it was happening, it was right after the Crucified, and I really did need to do something else. And you know, When Jeff and Dirk came and played with us, it just became clear that musically that wasn't a match. And, you know, that's a hard conversation to have, man. Hey, I'm going to quit the band and go do this other thing, and we're going to get a record deal and blah, blah, blah. You know what I mean? I think it was a tough thing, but I said, listen, when the time comes, let's get back together and make a record. And
yeah,
we had a few songs, you know, and Kevin and Jesse and Matt kept writing whenever they could. And once things kind of got rolling, there was that time when Steve Kravac was doing all these MXPX records, and
yeah,
Stavesacre and MXPX were really tight because our first two real tours were with MX, and we were friends with them because we were all kids, and but we were like the older brothers, you know, who watched their younger brothers like leap past everybody.
Yeah. Yeah.
That one of many, POD being the next, you know.
Wow.
You know, those guys should be so very proud of everything that they have accomplished.
Absolutely.
And it has nothing to do with any of us. That is their hard work. But we go, you know, go meet Steve Kravac, and he was like, you know, kind of a cool idea. I mean, this guy, if I did a punk rock record, I would like to do it with this guy. And then one day, I don't remember where we tracked it. It might have even been Moonstone, but we tracked a demo for Outer Circle, and kind of played coy with a little bit, you know. And Billy Power was working at Tooth and Nail at that point. He's like, "What's this? You're telling me there's a punk rock record that you made, and I didn't even know that you had this band? I've known you longer than everyone." And that is a fact. Wow. I mean, I've known Billy since I was 16. And, you know, like, I met him when I was 16, and we were pen pals when I was 14. He was annoyed that he wasn't the first person to hear the Outer Circle demo. So, yes, he liked it. He signed us. We put the record out, and it was like a cool thing to be able to do. I mean, what a luxury, man.
Yeah.
It's not like I made Tooth and Nail any money off of that record.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? They just put it out for fun and because it was a cool thing to do. I'm sure it generated some cash, but it was not a huge thing, but it was fun to do. And yeah. I still talk to Kevin, still talk to Jesse. I hear from Matt occasionally through them. We're just like different worlds, but it was nice. It was a nice thing to do. And I'm pretty proud of it. It sounded legit, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it definitely was, you know, a more, you know, Stavesacre's, you know, going a certain way, and this is going another. It's another outlet for you, obviously. Was there ever any talks of another record, or was it just a one and done?
The guys have tried to do some stuff. I can't do it anymore.
Yeah.
I don't, you know, I did that, and that was fun, but it's hard to record anything or write anything that you're not really in love with. And I'm in love with those dudes, and I love the songs that we wrote together. I just musically, as maybe in the where I'm at in my life, it's just not something that feels sincere for me. And it's nothing to do with them. And I'm sure it's nothing to do with them. It's me. And you can tell, you know, when you're not really there.
Sure.
The vocals aren't going to be there. You might be able to have a couple lines that you've had kind of tossed around in your head, but you're not going to deliver any kind of conviction with your tone of voice or your performance. So
yeah,
it's just not something I feel like doing.
Yeah, man, I get you. I get that. Well, let's talk about Neon Horse. Let's kind of, yeah, tell me how that kind of came together. Obviously, you mentioned you've worked with Jason over the years, and
yeah,
let's kind of talk about that and the two records that came after that.
So we did, when we did the demos for How to Live with a Curse, at that point, we had been going out to play cards with Martin for a long time. You know, those guys were all part of like a kind of a group of people that hung out together and played cards. And, you know, he's like, he built a studio at his house. He's like, just come over to the house and we'll demo some stuff. You know, Martin's a dad pretty much through and through.
Yeah.
He is very much, you know, he has no interest in being on camera. Notice a pretty consistent thing. He's not trying to do a bunch of interviews and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But he does like building things, and he likes writing things, I think. And I don't know, we he also just likes fellowship. We had good fellowship. We were tracking the demos for How to Live with a Curse, and you know, trying to get ready to go to the studio, and we did them with him, and they were sounding good. And then we just became friends through all that. And at one point he said, you know, Solomon, can you sing? Like, you can sing, you know? And I said, yeah, dude, I don't get a chance. You know, it's not like he's just like everybody else. We don't really listen to each other's records, dude. Like, I've never listened to a full Starfire 59.
Really?
It's not my thing. You know, it's weird. It's a weird, I don't know how to describe it.
Yeah.
I love Eric Collins. I don't listen to Mr. ENC. It's just not a thing I really do. You know, wow. I don't know why. It has nothing to do. I respect everything. I don't listen to MXPX records, POD, whatever. I respect everything everybody else is doing. It's just hard for me to get into it. Because I know them and I like mystery. I want there to be mystery in the music I'm listening to. That's really what it is. Here's a great example. I don't know David Bazan. I don't know him. You know, we've met, I guess, a couple times, but I don't think we've ever exchanged more than 10 words. And I listen to Dave Bazan records because there's mystery there, and I don't know what any of the songs are about, so they can be about whatever I want them to be about.
I get it.
I can have a personal connection to them that makes sense. Jason is one of my favorite people. I'm not trying to listen to his records because I totally know, you know, who he is. But if he's playing guitar, I'm cool with that.
Yeah.
there's still plenty of mystery there. I don't know if that's unhealthy. I probably need to go to therapy. I don't know. But so to write songs with him was a natural, oh yeah, you write songs with your buddies. That's what you do. You play cards, you go bowling, you golf, or you write songs with your buddies. And we had two of those things, so that works. And so, you know, now, I mean, Jason and I are still friends. I just saw him when I was in Los Angeles. I try to make time to go see the guy, at least get, you know, a cup of coffee or something. And we hit it off. And he's like, man, I want to do this, like, weird kind of punk rock thing. But, like, not, I don't know. I don't want to do just a straight punk thing. I want to do something like Iggy and the Stooges punk rock, you know?
Yeah.
But maybe, you know, try something weird. So let's just see what happens. So he sends me these stems, and, you know, I was living in Long Beach at the time. My wife and I, you know, Stavesacre wasn't doing much. So I was still waiting tables and attending bar at nightclubs. And I just had all these things in my head from tending bar at nightclubs. And that just what came out. That was my life. Amazing. I'm gonna sing about these spoiled brats who come in here and get, you know, just shit housed every night and give everybody a hard time. And that was sort of the impetus for those records. But one conversation that Martin and I had was, let's make a Christian rock record. Like an album that we as little Christian kids would have been absolutely blown away that this was one of our guys, you know?
Yeah.
So one thing that most people don't really know about Martin is that he is hilarious. He is one of the funniest dudes in music. And of all the guys that I know, I bet you no one person is ubiquitous enough to cover everybody's mindset is that, oh, that guy's funny. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
He's everywhere. Every weird genre of music, everyone who's ever known the guy, they know this dude has his own thing going on.
Yeah.
And especially when he gets together with some of his like old school guys, like Cloud from Velvet Blue.
Yeah.
And,
oh, yeah.
And, you know, Steve and Dale and Jason Martin together are a force to be reckoned with because Steve's awesome. Real straightforward, you know. Anyway, so a kind of a developed rule when we would track these songs would be, if I can make Martin laugh, I think I might have something, you know? And it was just like, I sent him the thing. I said, this is what I got. And he was cracking up. He's like, dude, come over here. Let's just do this. Let's just forget the stems. Let's just track some stuff and see what it comes out. And it would be dumb and dumber and dumber and dumber. You know, there was one part on the first album where he's like, on this break, you got to say something like the old school punk bands would do, like, you know, hey, man, you know, And that's in there. In the bathroom wall, I think, or maybe nothing free, nothing nice for you. There's something like that in there. And I want to say something. And it's to a guy I don't know, David Bazan, if you ever hear this. I watched the Low Tom live performance of the four songs on the radio station. And there's an interview with you where you say, oh, yeah, we just tried to make each other laugh. And I want you to know, I did not steal this from you. This is a thing. This was a rule. And I know it's documented somewhere. But I just saw that. I just saw those Low Tom videos like, you know, 2 weeks ago. And I'm like, that's my freaking line, man. It was literally like, dude, I would track a vocal, you know, and I look, I find a focal point on the wall. And that's just what my default thing. And I try to, you know, every once in a while, I look down at the line, and I track from a focal point. And a lot of people do that. But I would lay down something that I thought was cool. And I would immediately look over and see if Martin was laughing. And there's this one bit on I think it was maybe Cuckoo, where I was like, somebody pull the shades. That, I would just keep trying to make up voices. And when I did that and I looked over, dude, Martin was shaking violently. And it was such a blast. So
that's amazing.
That's what we did. We kind of created these two little personas that, you know, Norman and Martin, Martin being Martin Gore, and Norman being this filthy, whiskey drenched sounding guy that was like the Bon Scott portion of Neon Horse. And Norman was going to be my middle name when my dad tried to name me Mark Norman Solomon, and my mom said no. So that was kind of like my little, yeah.
That's hilarious. What I know when you first went out, it was kind of a mystery as to who you guys were. Was that kind of the goal?
We kept it hidden because we didn't want people to go, oh, this is the new Stavesacre record, or this is the new Starfire 59 record. We just wanted it to be its own thing.
Yeah, absolutely. Looking back on those records, just kind of talk me through, like, how do you feel about them looking back on them, and kind of, I guess, you know, looking, yeah, I guess just how your viewpoint on them looking back.
I will. So first of all, I want to say, I tried to leave you a little bumper there so that you could do your edit. And so if anybody's watching this and it seems like a weird transition, it is because at my age, the coffee and a full thing of water all hit at the same time.
Dude, I got you.
No getting around it, dude.
I get it.
So looking back on those things, dude, I love them, man. I still listen to them, you know. We even did that Zatchu Santa Claus cover, and every Christmas, man, that gets played to at least one or two of my nephews. About it, man. Yeah.
That's awesome, man. Any maybe possible future records at all?
Actually, you know, Martin and I were talking about trying to do, you know, maybe just do a couple songs just for fun.
Yeah.
Do a couple songs. You know, you can put stuff out so easy now. And then just, you know, if we decide to do two more, we'll do two more.
Yeah.
We're not trying to write a record. There's no time to write a record. But I have like four or five. There are four or five songs right at this moment that if Jason and I said, hey, let's go in the studio tomorrow, we could track five songs right now.
That's amazing. That's,
you know,
cool.
And just because we've had them for ages. You know.
But, that's awesome. Where did you, just out of curiosity, where did the name come from?
Neon Horse?
Yeah.
I honestly don't even remember. I mean, probably Martin. We wanted, at first we were called the Black Hand because Martin loved this idea of the Black Hand, which is like the shadowy side of the mafia. But then like, as we were going, he had read up on it. I guess like the Black Hand were like full on rapists and like pretty horrific people. So he's like, Solomon, man. Okay. I'm going to do this. And if I get in trouble, it's okay. Cause I'm old. So you have to let me. Okay. Ready? Solomon, man. We can't be called the Black Hand, man. it just couldn't happen. It had to change because, you know, You know, I get kind of weird. Tooth and Nail was going to put the record out. You know, I want to try to not make sure. Life hell for them.
Sure. So. Sure. That's awesome.
So Neon Horse Adventure, I don't know where it came from, but, you know, simple and weird and goofy. And
I think it
that
fits.
Those records are the most true to my personality of every album I've ever done. That's
I love fact. That. That's cool. Sweet, man. Well, let's talk about White Lighter. Okay. Man, I love this record, by the way.
Outstanding.
Yeah. Tell me how this kind of came together and maybe your thoughts on it as well.
Sure. So while doing all the Neon Horse records, while doing the How to Live with a Curse Stavesacre album and really everything after that with Steve Dale and Steve and Randy from Project 86 being involved in it was Randy Torres. With them being involved in everything, we were just kind of always doing stuff together. And Martin and Steve are pretty good buddies. And for a while, when we were doing that Neon Horse record, Steve would come in and he was kind of acting as Martin's engineer, you know, doing a lot of the editing and clipping through. What the hell is it called? Pro Tools, you know, compiling tracks, doing transitions and stuff like that. When you do edits, you know, you don't want it here. You want to make it nice and smooth. And so it becomes very tedious. And Steve was doing a lot of that and just, you know, plus I think he might have played bass on a couple of those Neon Horse records. And one day he said, you know, he just really wanted to do an album. With songs that required the ability to sing. And so we did this album and, you know, I tried to honor that request. And we wanted to do something that was kind of, that wasn't Neon Horse, but you know, yeah, there's some elements of the horse in there because Martin ends up playing with us a lot, but it was less about the weirdness and more about wanting to do that old Sabbath-y kind of rock, yeah. You know? And I loved that album. You know, Northern Records, Sky Anderson, everybody just calls him Anderson. I honestly couldn't tell you what his first name is. I keep thinking Ken, but that's a producer.
Mr.
Hey, Mr. Anderson. You know, everybody just calls him Anderson. And I'm sure he's – don't be mad. But he put together this small label called Northern Records.
Yeah.
And, you know, he really wanted to do this White Lighter record. It's just something he wanted to do. So he made it possible for us to record and press the album. We got Jared McNeely to do some mixing with Martin. He did mixing along with Randy Torres on the first two Neon Horse records. So it's definitely from that era of my musical life. And, you know, Steve kind of gave me carte blanche to do whatever I wanted artistically. And that was when, you know, Ryan Clark was still with Tooth and Nail. Or wasn't with Tooth and Nail anymore, but he was doing his own design stuff, I think.
Yeah.
So we were like, you know, hey, would you be willing to do it? And Anderson was willing to pay him. So, you know, we got some legit album artwork design.
Yeah, it looks so sick.
Fun.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it was fun.
What's,
I love those songs, dude.
Yeah, I was going to say, well, you're curious, like, looking back on it. I mean, was Tooth and Nail ever wanting to be involved? Or was it, you mentioned Northern, and was it just kind of like...
No, I don't think they were really even – I don't know if they were interested or not, but it really didn't even come as much of a conversation. I think they had already – if I remember correctly, they had already just sort of like, man, how are we going to put this out? Hey, I think Anderson wants to do it. Like, I don't, honestly don't remember how the genesis of that happened. But, yeah. And, you know, that was kind of at the I think Tooth and Nail might have been in a pretty gnarly transition at that point as well. So it's pretty late, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Well, let's talk about the Never Was podcast. Man, I really enjoyed, and I hope you still intend to do more. I really enjoyed it. And, you know, getting to know you over the years, it was just cool. I don't know, just to kind of hear your perspective on things and all that. So maybe talk me through what's going on with the podcast and maybe, you know, if there's any future plans for it.
So the future plan is this. I don't want to do Christian rock nostalgia. I have no interest in it at all.
No, I got you.
You know, I love the people, and the people that I interviewed on the show are all friends of mine who I was super stoked to talk to. And there's 50 more that I'd love to talk to. But what I would rather do is my own artistic show that is my own artistic creations. And I'd like to intersperse it with at least one, if not two or three stories, an episode. From an anonymous person. The idea is going to be to take somebody's story. I have to preface it this. I wanted to interview everybody. You know, yeah. If you look on the website, it's still up. It says everyone is interesting. And that's still my belief. Everybody has an interesting story. Here's the thing, man. Not everybody is a great interview. It can be. I know you've got to know this by now.
Yeah,
I'm probably not a great interview at points. Oh, and I'm sure it's gonna be, and it can be very challenging when it comes time to edit that stuff, especially if you have a certain way you want things to sound. It is crushing to crawl through an hour of audio, eliminating every time someone like my dumbass says. you know what I mean? Is painful. And you know, I just did one when I said, and you know, I bet you there's going to be 100 times on this podcast where I say, and you know, and it's, you don't realize you're doing it in conversation, but when it comes time to record that stuff, dude, it is painful. So I don't want to do that. What I like to do is kind of compile some thoughts and put them down on tape and intersperse them with whatever's on my mind. And that would bring me joy. And if nobody likes it, it's totally okay. I don't care. I have a thing that I want to talk about every week. I'm not an expert and don't claim to be, and I don't give a shit if anybody thinks they need to point out that I'm not an expert. Everyone knows I'm not. But I am sitting here living my life, and I'm watching things unfold, and they affect me. And I know there are people who feel the same way.
Yeah.
That being said, I want to hear your best story. What's your best story, Jeremy? You and I will talk on camera, not necessary. We will talk. We will record it. And then I am going to take your story, compile the elements of it into basically an autobiographical short story. A biographical short story that my interpretation of what you've just told me, let you hear it, say, I agree. I approve. And then I'm going to read it. And the idea is, I will not reveal whose story this is until after I've read it and given you, the listener, a chance to form your own opinions, hear what they had to say. And then I want to tell you who told me that story and see how I want to see what happens. Maybe nothing, but I believe that every person, I'm not going to just interview people who believe the same thing as me. I want to talk to people who disagree with me.
Yeah.
I want to take their story and compile a biographical short story and throw it down. I basically want to work as the voiceover guy for your biographical short story of this story that you have. But the idea is, because I can be Luke Wilson in Idiocracy, I can be the most mediocre person that there is, okay? Generic white guy. And allow you to form your own opinion as to who this person is, you know, and the idea is just to show there are so many similarities between all of us. And I don't know how we're going to fix what we are right now.
Yeah.
But I do believe that from my own experience, the best way I could find out that I am not better than, more understanding, scripturally more certain than everyone else, the best way for me to learn that was to meet new people that I had never met before and to have my worldview blown up in my face.
Yeah.
And I think it's important for people to hear other stories.
Absolutely.
When you hear stories from people who've lived in Gaza, what's going on there?
Yeah.
But if you hear it without any of the charge elements, any of the triggering elements that cause you to put up your little boundaries, I never in a million years would have believed how radicalized my mind has become over the last 22 years. It's come from exposure. I voted for George Bush, dude. I was happy George Bush was the president. So we have a tough guy in there to deal with this thing that has happened in this country, right?
Yeah.
9/11 needed to be dealt with. And I was wrong on so many levels. And every day that followed after that, it forced me to say, like, dude, you don't know shit.
Yeah.
And your belief system is broken, man. You know, we killed all these people in Iraq on a lie.
Yeah.
And I stood by and said, well, at least we got a tough guy. It's like, what?
Yeah.
You know, but that comes from an ignorance. It comes from an ignorance and living a life in which you don't have to see the brown people getting killed in a foreign country. And I'm not trying to preach, dude. I'm really not. I'm trying to just state historical fact. That is what happened to me. I was taught a certain way. I lived a certain way. I believed a certain way. And in the immortal words of Brian Carlstrom, I was loud, confident, and wrong. I don't know anything, dude.
Yeah.
You know, but here I am talking out of my ass like I have some authority. So all I want to do is a show that I can feel good about artistically and a show that I feel like gives other people a chance to have their sides set, have their story told without people throwing up stop signs until they're done. You know, does that make sense?
Absolutely. And that sounds incredible, to be honest with you. I think
it might suck, dude. It might suck. I don't know.
You know, I get what you're saying. And, you know, you're right. It's like sometimes we need the human element of it, you know, just, you know, looking at the human element instead of, you know, how I feel or, you know, just stepping back and not making about us at this moment and like thinking there's other people affected. I totally get it. 100%. I think that sounds incredible. And man, that sounds interesting. I hope you know, do that soon. That would be really cool to hear.
So do I. So does my wife, because I've been paying for my website to stay open for a minute, man.
Yeah, man. I got you. No worries. Awesome, man. Well, listen, I know you can't predict the future, man, but tell me what the future looks like for you. I know you kind of just described that portion of it, but maybe what does the future look like for you?
The future looks like if I can continue in the program that I'm on right now, I will have an opportunity to present something to people soon. That is that, a reflection of that art. There's an element to it that I don't want to say out loud because I want to make it happen before. I would like to under-promise and over-deliver.
No, I got you.
And at this point, it's just a lot of talking. Everybody's got ideas. Anyone who says they're an idea man, welcome. You're part of the human race. Not everybody has work ethic. You are doing a show, Jeremy. You take the time to talk to a person, record the show, edit the show, put the show into a place where people can listen to it. And it is sincere. And that means something, dude. You know, when
thank you.
My buddy Josh Bumpgaletta, he's an artist.
Oh, yeah, he's great.
Small town illustrator, you know, his style is his style. And the only way he has gotten to the point he's at to have a style that is recognizable is by him just continuing to do it. And there are people who, you know, you have to be good, obviously. But there's plenty of talent out there and not a lot of hustle. But there's also people who hustle with no talent. So
yeah.
I don't want to be either of those. I like to be a good balance. I think Josh is a great example of that balance between talent and hustle. You know, and you know, there are so many other people. Look at the Clark brothers. We talked about them earlier.
Yeah.
I mean, who could, they're freaking icons, man.
No, I know. I just had Don on last week.
You know, there are things that people, my buddy Wade that I mentioned, the drummer from Neon Horse, that guy somehow hustled his way into the authority on vintage pinball machines. How is that a thing?
It's amazing.
So that's it. I would like to do that. That's the future, to really fully invest in something that just is my own, but you have to do it.
Yeah, absolutely. Got to take the leap of faith. So, yeah. Mark, dude, this has been so cool, man. I've really been looking forward to talking to you. It's been a while since we got to talk and catch up. So,
yeah, man. Yeah.
I appreciate you coming on and telling me these cool stories, and I'm glad I could be part of your journey.
And, you know, for you and for anyone who's listening, if you haven't seen the cable management at the White House video that's on Reddit right now, you can see how Jeremy and I met. That world is where we met.
Dude, oh my!
Did you watch the video, man?
Yes, I.
It is.
I know.
My buddy Cooper said, "I can't watch it again. I'm afraid I'm going to break out in hives."
I know. It definitely like brings up feelings for sure. Mark, right, you rule, dude. Awesome. It was so good to talk to you, and hopefully we get to hang out soon at some point.
Buddy.
And we'll go from there, buddy.
I'll be up in Jacksonville this year. I think we come up there.
You think? So we'll when?
See. Yeah, well, I think so. Really? Later on in the season, I think we're up
there. Well, shoot me a text. So I want to get together then.
Absolutely, man.
All right, Mark. I'll talk to you soon. All right.
Yes.
All right, bye. All right, bye-bye.
Hey, thank you to the listener for tuning into this latest episode. I could not do it without you, so thank you very much. If you'd like to add me on Instagram and Facebook, at The Rumors Are True Cast. If you'd like to like and subscribe, you know how to do that. So thank you again for the support and all the nice messages and kind words. It's been really awesome. Thank you to Mark Salomon, busy, busy man. So I really appreciate your time. It's been awesome to reconnect and just hear these cool stories. Man, awesome. Thank you so much for what you've done in my life and a lot of these people's, these listeners' minds as well. So thank you, Mark. Got some incredible artists on the horizon. I know I say it weekly, but man, I'm really grateful again for this opportunity. So, hey, nostalgia, guys, still a hell of a drug.